David, good to have you guys. We'll have some people dropping on here. I'm excited about Mindset Mondays this week. A lot of things going on in the market, a lot of things going on in the industry, in the world. We're getting a lot of questions on this. The reason I was excited about it and bringing Denny on here is that, you know, having a conversation that you can have, utilize with somebody and talk to them a little bit differently than you wouldn't normally, because there's a lot of things going on in the world. So you got to somehow in real estate, we've got to keep in touch with our people and we got to come from care at the same time. Would y'all agree?
Yep.
And so, Chris, I was talking to Chris the other day. And so our guest today is Denny Grimes, and Denny Grimes is a mega agent out of South Florida, I guess, West Florida, right? What city are you in, Denny?
Yeah, we're on the Gulf Coast, Southwest Florida, Naples, Fort Myers area.
There you go. Naples, Fort Myers, terrible place to live. How do you live there? It's terrible. And so he's not only a mega agent with a large team, he went through the last shift, probably gone through a couple shifts, to be honest with you. And he also is a national speaker. He sees a lot of things going on in the industry. And he's a bold coach, which I love seeing him on a regular basis. And he's also married to Kristen Cole. Kristen Cole's his wife. And I was talking to Kristen the other day, and he says, well, Denny's got some great scripts he's been using in the shift. And, you know, I think we're all, when we go back and look at the shift of 7, 8, and 9, we kind of want to relate it to that. And be honest with you, it's similar, yet we got different things we're battling. And so we've got to maybe have different scripts for doing it. So, guys, I just want a big gratitude. We got Denny until the bottom of the hour, and then maybe we can mastermind after that and go from there. So, guys, welcome, Denny. Denny, thanks for joining us today. I really appreciate that.
You bet. Arizona's kind of my second home. So, hey, I'm not totally set up in my studio, and you guys are controlling it. So I have the choice to either see the PowerPoint, which is behind me, or the Zoom call. So I trust you guys can see me and the PowerPoint. Is that accurate?
So, yes. So awesome. Everybody, I would work from speaker view instead of gallery view in this case right now. And if you find yourself if somebody speaks and it doesn't go back to Denny on the top left of your screen, it's because you probably pinned a video. So you'll want to unpin that video. So when Denny's talking, it will take over on your screen and you can see it on there. So a little Zoom 101.
Yeah, you can be able to see the screen and me. So anyway, yes. And so I've been through a lot of these things, and I'm probably 35 years into business. So I'm low risk for being outscripted by a buyer and seller. However, according to the CDC, at my age, I'm high risk to get the virus, right? So having been through all of this, one of the things I was concerned about, David, is because I've seen so many uncertain environments, that I was concerned that I wasn't concerned. You know what I mean? We all know, and Bold teaches us this, and you guys live with a Bold and work with a Bold coach, is that our mindset is very, very important in everything, particularly with uncertainty ahead. Because sometimes an agent will read this uncertainty and they'll get a little nail biting and get a little worried because they're uncertain. Yet here's the thing. When people are uncertain, they automatically go to the people that have the confidence, that have the answers. And so in the last shift, you guys were there in Arizona in 2006, completely different than this one. And that's not really the topic of this little 30-minute gig. And you probably have already heard that story before. However, is that when that shift took place, all of the help you sells and the purple bricks and the red things and all the things, the hope you sells went away. And we're seeing the same thing right now. There was Inman published it just the other day where Zillow is no longer making instant offers, and Quicken Loans are basically all these national companies that were like rushing in to take care of, to service our customers in a great market are gone. Mm-hmm. Who's left? We are. And the thing is, if we basically understand that uncertainty ahead breeds fear. And this is what I want us to kind of internalize. Write this down. This is a great script to talk to your buyers and sellers, is that fear is a terrible advisor. Now, is there fear in the marketplace more so now than it was 30 or 45 days ago?
Hey, would you say fear is a terrible what?
Terrible advisor. Can you see it on screen?
Oh, got it.
So fear is a terrible advisor. So there is more fear and uncertainty. And when there's uncertainty, they're looking for the expert. They're looking for something to tie their rope to that's solid, which means we have to be solid. Now, there's probably no better time right now to contact your people than now. In fact, if you were going to call anyone in your sphere, and I say this jokingly, you guys, because they talked about social distancing. When the president came out with that, I'm thinking, David, we've been a Bold coach for the last X number of years. Agents have been failing for the last 10 years because they've been practicing social distancing.
That's funny.
Now is the time to talk to people because you know what's in the market. Yes, there's fear. There's also a level of humanity. People are getting in touch with people again. And you can make a call to anyone, anywhere, and talk to them about how you're doing. Never bring up real estate because we are all, for the very first time, kind of in the same boat. Would you not agree?
Yeah.
Now, so we'll get into some role play. And I guess, did anyone turn in any concerns, objections they may be getting, David, that we can talk about here in a minute?
Well, I told them to bring it with them. And guys, we have a chat box up here. I mean, you're welcome to speak as well. Some people like using the chat box. Like objections or challenges or kind of what's on your mind of how you would handle something. You got a huge opportunity right here. So I told him to bring it to the call with him.
Okay, so I'll let him type into the chat in just a second. Here's what I want you to get a picture of. We've all been parents, we've raised kids, and we take our little one to school for the very first day of kindergarten or first grade. And generally kids fall into one of two categories. You know, they stand at the door, you're there, you're walking to their classroom. They either run in there and think, oh, mom, don't come back for a week because they love playing with other kids, probably a high I in the future, right? Or they're a leg clinger honor. Did anyone on the call ever have a leg clinger honor? They didn't want to go in. Why? Because there was fear. What did you tell them? What did you tell them? You probably just didn't kick them in the butt and tell them to get in there. You said, hey, look, honey, it's going to be okay. Mom, your dad will be back. You'll have fun, blah, blah, blah. We were the voice of reason. Our buyers and sellers right now are standing at the precipice of fear. What is going to happen next? And this is the first time, and if you've been in real estate less than 10 years, you've never had to deal with a market that was not heading in more than one direction. You've had an upward moving market for the last 10 years, and now there's a question mark in the marketplace for the first time. Many of these people you're talking to bought a home in the last 10 years, and you know what? They don't really know. They're looking for someone to say, it's okay. It's okay to move forward. So we think about the bold law come from contribution and shift. You know, I know that James Shaw is every day at 8 o'clock, I think Eastern. You guys are probably knowing about this, is talking about the shift book each and every day. There's one page in here that I want to share with you because I want you to know that Gary, this is what Gary says. Now he's talking about overcoming buyer reluctance. Is there buyer reluctance in the marketplace now? We're seeing it. Is there seller reluctance in a buyer in a market right now? We're seeing it. So I'm going to read it as a buyer, although it does apply for a seller. When people have good reason to buy or sell, they do just that. When the market changes, it can throw people off balance. You guys get that. They're off balance. Some of them don't know what to do. You know, once they stock up on toilet paper, now what, right? All of a sudden, they're not sure of themselves, and they're hesitant to move forward. They're at the door of the kindergarten, and they're looking for someone to give them some guidance. Do you have enough confidence? And you may not have been through. There's enough wisdom collectively in KW or in your region or in your market center that can help you have confidence. That's my goal today, is to give you confidence to be the parent, not the child. They need someone to intervene and help them overcome their reluctance. They need someone to show them that's okay and give them permission to buy or sell now. Last point. Gary is patting us on the back with this sentence. In the end, you are being the highest level of fiduciary when you don't let should-be buyers or should-be sellers cave into their sense that it's better to wait. The reality that people must face is that their expectations, their own thoughts, may be faulty. That's an amen, hallelujah, pass the plate. And so what I want to do is help you look at this a little bit different and give you a little, some tools. For example, this is one that I shared with my team, And one of my newer agents told me that she used this script on her buyer yesterday. Now, everyone's talking about, you know, C-19 and cures, this, that, and the other. So here's the picture. So imagine we're role playing, and David, you've got your mic on, right?
Yep.
So just do a short little role play. I don't know what your expectation is. I mean, you could be a buyer or seller, you know, okay, in contract, out of contract, whatever. And you may want to hesitate. So let's just say Danny, I was ready to buy a house. I got pre-approved, and I'm just a little uncertain right now. So let me ask you guys a question. You just kind of answer it in your own mind. When you have a buyer or seller that basically wants to back out of the market for now, maybe take their home off the market. Maybe it's a buyer, even worse, wants to cancel the contract for a commission you've already spent. What's the very first thought that goes through your mind when that happens?
So when what now?
What's the first thought that goes through your mind when one of your buyers or sellers say, I'm going to wait, or I want us to go ahead and take our house off the market until we get through this mess?
My first thought is, what's their motivation? What's their reason to buy or sell?
Okay, awesome. However, can you slow it down, David? What might be the very human first nanosecond thought?
Freak out?
Well, yes, and here's the thing. Oh no, that's bad for me.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, freak out. Sure, gotcha now.
Now, so, and here's the deal, and this is totally true. This is why David did not have this as his first thing, because the more you're in real estate, the more you've been through this, the more pipeline you have, the less you're concerned about your own income and the more you're concerned about theirs. And when we can get to that place, regardless of where you are in your pipeline, in your cash flow, in your business, now we can focus on their needs. Because if they can smell us coming, and the first things out of our mouth is, well, that would be a bad thing to do. We start telling them all the reasons why they shouldn't do what they're doing. Are we attracting them to the right decision or pushing them away from it? So this is one of the scripts that I use, David. So understand you basically, you're thinking about maybe waiting, right? Before you move, before you buy a house, you decide to wait.
Because I, you know, worried about my spouse's job. I don't know if she's going to keep her job. Got no idea what's going to happen. I'm just really nervous to, you know, a little scared to buy.
Right. So what I'm going to do is I'm not going to handle all that right now. I just want to show and share this metaphor with you. Well, understand that, David. Let me ask you, if a doctor were to ever give you a prescription for something that was, you know, maybe bothering you, like you had a tummy ache all the time, would you want to know the side effects of taking the medicine?
Yes.
So as your real estate professional, do you mind if I share with you the side effects of the decision you're about to make?
Yeah, sure.
Now, if you approach them like that, in that type of metaphor, and there could be other metaphors, here's the question. Are there side effects for the decision they're about to make? Yes or no?
Yes.
There absolutely are. Now, I don't know, and you know, when you counsel them, you may agree that it's maybe they're in their best interest not to proceed. If you take your interest away, it may be in their best interest not to proceed. However, most people, if they're acting out of fear, they're acting out of a rash judgment, and fear is not a very good, it's not a very good mindset to be in and making important decisions. So that's just a quick mental analogy you can use, and it can work. It will slow them down because sometimes they don't think about the side effects.
Right, they're reacting. Sometimes they're just reacting.
They are reacting. And so basically when they're in fear, they're in emotion sometimes, and it says logic makes them think, emotion makes them act. Yes. And however, you know, sometimes we have to overcome that a little bit with adding a little logic or maybe another positive emotion. Let me ask you a question, David. I know that you've got, I'll just pick on you for a moment because I know your mic is open. If you had your son or daughter and they were basically out camping and they got cell phone reception and, you know, they're out, it's dark, and they were to call you and say, hey, Dad, I don't know where I am. I'm lost. Now, let's just assume it's your favorite kid. You don't hang up on them. Okay, so they're lost. What would be your first question?
Well, they're lost. And so their cell phone works. Does your map work on your phone?
I can't make head nor tails out of it. What would be your next question?
I'm going to miss you.
You said, I'm going to miss you.
I'm going to miss you.
Well, where were you last at?
There you go.
There you go. Thank you, Angie. She lives in the mountains.
All right. So I don't know who said that. David, you're on mute now, and I'm talking to this girl. Okay. So you would ask, well, where are you?
Yeah. Where were you last at? Sure. Where was the last place you were at?
Remember that, you guys, because when people are basically now coming to you with some concerns, and we're going to go through the formula here in a minute and do a role play over the next 12 minutes, find out where they are. Don't assume you know where they are. Find out where you are. Now, when I taught in a market center, when Kristen and I did a few months ago, you might have seen something similar to this. So, David, has anyone typed in any kind of objection or concern that they want to handle? This is when we're going to do a little quick role play.
Well, I did one while ago, and anybody else, we have some really good agents on this call. What's an objection, guys, that you, a scenario of today's market? Jay put on there, I just repeated Jay's about, I don't want to buy, what about my spouse? You can always address that one, Denny. The exact one says, I'm not sure if my spouse is going to keep their job. We're a little scared to buy. That's one. Another one we're hearing quite often. Angie, what are you getting on the call this morning on scripts and objection handlers? You remember any?
Well, we actually were moving forward with for sale by owners. So
specifically, very cool.
Yeah, specifically because there's people that are still out in the market right there who would be able to use our services. I know one of the ones that I'm experiencing as a listing agent that a lot of people, as much as they want to get their homes on the market, are really, really scared about contracting the virus in their homes.
Okay.
And having to overcome those objections.
Yeah, I'd love to hear, Denny, how you would, that's actually not an uncommon one there. Safety, cleansiness, how do you sell a house?
Okay. So that's an excellent one. We're actually getting that too. So you guys, you know, this is recorded. I don't know if the slides are recorded, so you can take a snapshot, a screenshot or whatever, or a picture of that, or write it down. This is very similar to the formula that we teach in Bold, and it's then Tommy Hopkins and Zig Ziglar and all that. However, people generally don't go deep enough into that. Everyone kind of understands the acknowledgement. Well, you know, I understand how you feel, Mr. and Mrs. Seller. There's a lot of ways to do that. Number one, you want to make them feel comfortable. Then you want to isolate. Now, so watch how I do this. And I think, and just let's just role play. Is it Stacy I'm talking to?
Angie,
thank you. All right. So Angie, what I hear you saying is that you still want to sell, right?
Yes.
And you're concerned about putting your home on the market now. Is that what you said?
Yes. I'm just really concerned about strangers coming through our home that we don't know and them touching surfaces and putting my family in danger of contracting the virus.
Okay. So other than maybe the safety is here, I'm going to isolate. I'm going to unload the groceries before I unpack them. Other than the safety concern, is there any other reason why you wouldn't allow me to activate your home right away?
No, there isn't.
So then let me ask you, if we can mitigate or solve the concern you have about the safety, would you proceed?
Absolutely. I just want to keep my family safe.
I totally agree with that. So let me ask you, what would have to happen to give you a comfort level that if your home is for sale, that your family would be safe if somebody wanted to look at it?
Well, I would have to know that my home is safe so that we could come back home and not have fear of the virus. And I just don't see how that can happen.
Well, okay. So if we can make that happen, maybe they have masks and maybe they have gloves and booties and they don't touch anything. How would you feel about that?
I'd still be nervous, but it's, you know, it does make it a little bit better. I just don't know how we can police that.
Well, I don't know either. However, there's some side effects for the decision you're about to make. You would want your doctor to tell you, wouldn't you?
Yes, I would.
So here's the thing, and I'm going to step out of role. I had an aha in the last few days doing this thing because I've come, there is a difference between not caring what they do. Because you might care, you want them to do the right thing, There's a difference between not caring and not being attached to the outcome.
Yep, I agree.
Here's the thing. I want you to make the right decision.
Hey, Denny, repeat that, because I think that's something good to write down. I think people get that confused quite often. Mm-hmm. I heard it. There's a difference between not caring and not being.
Yes. I mean, yes, there's a difference between not caring. I was talking to someone. Let me just say it so you can write it down. There's a difference between not caring, caring, C-A-R-I-N-G, and not being attached to the outcome. There's a difference. Now, case in point, I was talking to someone who was thinking about joining my team. And I said, it was actually joining Bold, David. I don't really care if you join Bold. Now, that was inaccurate. I do care, because I know Bold Pivot would be the right thing for them. However, I'm not attached to the outcome, meaning I'm not going to lose sleep and worry about someone making the decisions I can't control. So you always want so if you can understand that internally, and even when your kids, I mean, you got a son that's dating a girl that maybe you didn't really approve of, and so you care what your son does, or maybe he's going to a different college. However, they have to make their own decisions. Our clients do too. So is it okay? So watch this. Now I'm gonna find out what the concern is of, you know, so you want to have your family safe. Would you like to know, Angie, the side effects?
Yes.
So are we in a point of uncertainty right now?
Yes.
Do you feel the markets, how long do you think it's going to take before the uncertainty's gone?
I have no idea. That's the scary part. I work in the healthcare industry, and I just see how it's been devastating.
Do you think it's going to get worse before it gets better?
I do.
Okay. So were you around in 2006?
Yes.
Do you remember what the market did then?
Yes.
So when the uncertainty entered, and we're kind of in the beginning of that uncertainty, the sellers that made the decision sooner, did they win? Or the sellers that made this decision much later, did they win?
The ones who did it sooner.
Okay, so would you not agree that there, one of the side effects from waiting may be a loss of equity? So, I mean, would it be okay if we wait and you realize that maybe your home sells for $40,000 less?
I see.
See what I'm doing there, you guys? There is a pain factor, because there are side effects. If there weren't side effects, I would take every pill out there so to get my hair to grow again, right? I just don't want my feet to fall off. So there's danger there's in doing things. And if you quantify it in some sort of a fashion, put them in a pain pleasure threshold, they may come around to the fact that, you know what, I don't want to wait. Then if you don't want to wait, how can we do it now? What if only two people had to look at your house to buy it, and we could wrap them in bubble wrap and cellophane and hazmat suits? Would you feel comfortable if only two people had to do it, walk through your home?
Yeah, I mean, that would make it better. The less people have to come through, the better off I'm going to feel.
And here's the other thing, you guys, you know that can be done virtually. I didn't go to that yet. I didn't go to that yet, because here's the thing. You know what's puzzling, Angie, about your decision right now?
What's that?
You are in the best potential market for a seller that you could imagine. Because, you know, generally the buyers are crawling around like fire ants, right? Mm-hmm. Where do you think that basically the non-serious buyers are? Do you think they're out looking at homes, or do you think you're basically, you know, there's inside playing Candy Crush?
Yeah, I'd say they're sitting on the couch.
And do you think other sellers are hesitating putting their home on the market because of the same concerns you voiced?
Probably.
So how would you like to be in the Indianapolis 500 and only three cars racing?
Nice. I like that.
And basically the buyers that are out there are going to be serious, may put more money in your pocket. So why don't we focus on the plan, not the problem. Let's figure out how we can make it safe for you, and you can basically have your cake and eat it too. Does that make sense?
It does. Thank you.
So, okay, I'll stop there. You know, let's unpack that. What's your ahas? Any other things? There's more than one way to play a chess match, guys. That's just the way I chose to do it.
Gina, do you think there'll be a chance in this time when people legitimately do call timeout and they like, let's say somebody definitely doesn't have to buy right now, and they decide, you know what, I'm going to go ahead and hold off. So I'll give you another one because like Dan's got a in here. Why would I not wait for the market to go back down? Basically, I'm going to wait for the market to come down, and I'll buy it when it's cheaper, when it's less money. Anything how you would handle that objection?
Yeah, and I have a hard stop here in a couple minutes, so I'll go real fast. Well, when will that be, by the way, David?
When will what be?
When the market goes down, where you feel how far would it have to go down to make you feel comfortable to step into it?
Well, I just, you know, right now, it's like I'm still living with my in-laws, and if I just stay here, maybe I wait a couple of months when this all passes by, and if the market goes down, then, you know, then I'll buy this. I don't know. That's what I was thinking.
All right. I'm going to give you a great script. Get ready. Well, you know, that's kind of puzzling. I mean, y'all like to buy low. However, you know from the textbook when the best time to buy is?
When?
The best time to buy is when sellers fear tomorrow is worse than today. Does that exist now?
Yes. Yeah.
Now, and it might exist tomorrow. However, as soon as that market changes, your negotiating strength is gone. And no one knows where the bottom's going to be. And with Gary has the falling lines, tell me when it's going to stop. Look at the stock market. People were waiting to get in, and it dropped. Then it was below 20, and it was down to 18. Now it's up to 23 or 24. I wonder why people didn't get in at the bottom, because the bottom disappears very quickly.
Yeah.
So, and yes, David, there are people that, you know, probably should wait.
Yeah.
And that's okay. If you go through the pros and cons, give them the side effects of their waiting, and they still want to wait, and it's okay. I'm not attached to the outcome. Whatever's best for you. Listen, if you want to put your home on the market in 6 months, I'll be here.
Yeah.
And I'll be ready.
Which of the agents that make it through this shift, you got 1 minute, we're right on your time, you got to go. What do you think is going to be the magic sauce for somebody right now? And let's say we're out of this in a month or two, got some residual effects, we're on our way out. What's the magic potion for somebody that they need to be doing right now?
Well, this is what I'm doing. I didn't do it the last time. Get really skinny. Every dollar matters right now, because we don't know how long it's going to be. So basically, if you're going to go in Gilligan's Island, I don't know how they had all those clothes and stuff for a 3-hour tour. However, you want to make sure that you conserve your money and your resource. So, and then basically, the more calls you make to your sphere and database, now is the time to do it rejection-free. As soon as it turns around, you will have a pipeline ready to do business with you, because you know what? The major competitors, I don't think Zillow's making any offers right now. So that's what I would do, and that's not rocket science, David. That's my advice.
Awesome. Denny, thank you so much for joining us. That was good. That was a lot of material in a short time. Thanks for joining us. Maybe we'll have you on again someday, okay?
Thank you, David. See you guys. Bye.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
All right, guys. Give me some takeaways. I love some of those lines in there.
Yeah.
What are some of your takeaways? There's Denny.
Hey, David. I really loved that Denny got the person at the other end of his conversation answering questions to make up their own mind and determining. Instead of him telling them what they should do, he would prompt them with questions that would lead them to an educated choice for themselves.
Yep. Self-discovery.
Yeah. I 100% agree, Jody. You know, you focus around their motivation. And I think what we have to come to realization with right now is that we have different objections. Like, there's no scriptbook that was written for, I don't want to get a virus.
Right.
That's reality. If somebody needs to sell their house today, you may have to have a conversation of strategizing with them on ways to sell their house without somebody even coming in. Let's just say you do something like, when they do go under contract, you do talk to the sellers about, all right, we'd like to, during the inspection period, have them come see the house during the inspection period. What would you need to see for them to be able to come in and see the house physically? You know, it's like working with an investor, right? An out-of-town investor. So, I think focusing on motivation and understanding some people may push off. The people with the biggest pipelines at the end of this are going to be the ones that win.
Yeah. I agree.
Yeah. You know, it's a couple calls today. It's May and June. You know, what is April going to look like for new contracts? That's my concern right now. So, it's the same thing we've always coached and taught on, Jody, and that is focus on motivation. How you handle it may be different. Right. Anybody else? I know we got some great agents on here. Any other takeaways? That was pretty compact. Yes.
I'll throw in the thought that I'm working on with the current listing that I have. My sellers are still committed to selling the house. So now, of course, we're into, you know, you try and hold an open house or getting either pushed back because why are you doing this to expose the virus, that kind of thing, or people simply don't want to be out and about to do so. So I think we're going to see, and actually through this process, I actually believe that this may become the norm in the future. On the other side of this is we kind of have to go back, step back just a little bit. And it was kind of fun when we first started the little 4-minute tours on Facebook of doing a house. Because you can look at a house in pictures, but there's a little bit about standing in the space and how it's comfortable. You know, pictures are one thing, but when you go, when the people actually come to the house, there have been many times when, I've had people go, you know, well, we looked at the pictures online, but now we're standing in the house and this is really different than what we saw before. I think those walkthrough videos offer the option of getting a little more real-time space, a little more real-time description, a little more opportunity to show some details. So if you have that available, it's not much more than what the pictures are on the MLS, but what it does allow is if someone actually sees the video and identifies this as, you know, we'd really like to see this house, then you have the ability to whittle down from open houses where random people are coming in to, we have this one client that's interested in coming in. We can coach them on how we're going to go through the house, but we want to get them in the house to see it. So now you talk about what not to touch, booties, gloves, whatever the case may be. But I think that 4-minute tour that I used to do on the cell phone when I was doing an open house and walk through the house can aid in whittling down the number of people that may truly want to see the house.
Yep, I agree.
This is a great time for us to fine tune our skills of using technology so we can expose the house to more people. When we go to a regular market, learning how to do these things is still, you know, I think we still do them. Yep. You just might not go to the booties and the cleaning and the all those things. So, Larry, I agree with you. So anybody else, takeaways? And right now we're talking about scripts and dialogues of the market of the moment, objection handling, things like that. Any other comments in here on how you handle certain scenarios even? All right, this is the participation part of the program.
I wanted to just say I really appreciated when Denny said that the seller or even buyer's fear of tomorrow when it outweighs what is existing today. Yeah. I think that really is something to really dig into in determining their motivation.
He had some really good lines in there. I like this not caring and not being attached to the outcome was a great one, I thought.
Yep, that there is a difference.
There is a huge, I really, really like that because not getting attached to the outcome is something we all like. Why do most people get attached to the outcome, by the way?
Money.
For their money, yes, for their self-preservation, yeah.
Yeah. Or just, you know, let's just say this more than just being more vain about it. Just they got to pay their bills. They're scared.
Yeah. But building the pipeline, not being tied to the outcome of getting the business today and looking at it is a building your pipeline down the road where it could still turn into money. If you focus on that rather than just, you know, I'm not going to get anything today, so why bother? I think that's what's going to keep us motivated to keep going and making those calls.
Yeah, I agree. All right. Well, guys, I'm going to continue to bring in all stars, some local, some out of town on Mindset Mondays. Sometimes I'm blocking out 1 to 2. He had a hard stop at 1:30. And we can get a lot done in 30 minutes most of the time. He's a content king though. He always has content. He always has slides. He's just one of those guys. Sometimes I'll have others. So, put in your calendar every Monday at 1 p.m. is Mindset Mondays. I have a feeling I won't stop doing these once we get into a regular life again. I think I'll keep doing these right here and keep them going. So, guys, I appreciate it. I'm going to hit stop right now because she handed over stop recording.